So after this very interesting morning in which we are listening about securities, about banking, about everything, there is still a sector missed, but we will correct that. It's topic of insurance. Next speaker is Mr. Carlos Montalvo Rebuelta. He's a chartered certified accountant and is also the Secretary General of the Committee of European Insurance and Occupational Pension Supervisors since September 2007. And prior to that, Mr. Revuelta was an insurance supervisor in Spain, in the Spanish Insurance Supervisory Authority, where he headed the international area of the Supervisory Department and coordinated the insurance group and financial and conglomerate related issues. The main topic is that recently, the European Council has approved the European System of Financial Supervisors, including securities, including banking, and also including insurance. Insurance is working a lot with the Solvency II, that is closely related with Basel II, for ratio solvency ratio. And Mr. Revuelta is the key person to explain the intricacies of this kind of topic. Mr. Revuelta.
Thank you, and thank you very much for inviting CEOIPS to give our views with regards to what's going on in the insurance sector. As you rightly mentioned, many comments have been spread about banking, some comments about securities, but not much about insurance. And believe it or not, we are also part of the financial sector. So that's what I am here to explain who we are, what we are doing, what's this whole Solvency II thing about, and last but not least, within Solvency II, develop more in the area which definitely is of the utmost interest to the people here, which is linked to reporting and potential applicabilities or use of tools like XBRL. I suppose that this is the IT solution to move my slides, and I would like to share with you basically, as I mentioned, a little bit, not too much time, on who we are, and on that I would like to be transparent, as we supervisors always are. I'm going to recycle some slides that I prepared a couple of years ago, basically for my wife to explain her what CEOIPS was about and what I was supposed to do in CEOIPS. By the way, if you don't understand at the end of this presentation who we are and what we do, don't worry, nor did my wife, but it's true to say that she's a banker, and you know bankers and their approach to insurance. Anyway, who we are, basically we are the body that tries to put together the supervisors and regulators from both the insurance and occupational pensions area and the relevant stakeholders in both areas. Why I say the relevant stakeholders? Mainly because we have, you can see it over there, a consultative panel that represents academics, represents insurance industry, consumers, end users, etc., etc. How we do our work? Well, basically, we try to integrate our views together with the views of our masters, European Commission and European institutions on the basis of independence, of course, and of our stakeholders. CEOIPS was created in 2004 as a European body, not a European institution, because basically a European institution demands an amendment in the treaty. And this, let's say, resolution from the European Commission has been recently amended in 2009 and will be significantly amended in the year 2010 because CEOIPS will become a so-called EIOPA, which is the European Insurance and Occupational Pensions Agency. That, among other things, will have binding powers. You see here that Solvency II is clearly one of the main areas of concern and workload to us, and within Solvency II I would like to mention this internal governance, supervisory review, and reporting aspects group, which is the one dealing right now with Pillar 2 and Pillar 3 related issues. How do we work? And what do we do? First, what do we do? It's clearly in our work program 2009. It's insurance, it's pensions, it's consumer protection, which is the main aim of supervisors, at least in the insurance sector. It has to do with financial stability. It has to do with joint work with our banking and securities colleagues. And in the year 2010 and 2012, it will have a lot to do with what is being discussed here. Because in this new EIOPA, there is, among our new tasks and roles, the idea of putting and setting up together a centralized database for European data, That's exactly the same request that our banking colleagues and securities colleagues have, by the way. And in the year 2012, another request, looks like we work basically on demand, coming from ECOFIN this time, will demand common reporting formats for the insurance sector and consistent reporting formats with regards to the financial sector. So, for example, for financial conglomerates, there is, and there could be a clear link. This is a little bit of an image of how we work and what we do. Well, we consult the stakeholders, we have meetings, we put together experts, and we try to get workable solutions and balance views. Well, it's up to you to decide and to determine whether we are succeeding with this or not. As I said, this is who we are and what we do broadly, and be prepared for Solvency II. This is Solvency II. This is a huge tsunami. And why we use a tsunami? Well, basically because we are putting forward waves, huge waves, of advice for our stakeholders to consult. May I mention that in 10 days' time there will be another one, around 800 to 900 pages upcoming, 10 weeks for consultation. So I guess our stakeholders will enjoy a nice summer vacation by the sea, quite close to the tsunami, may I say. And I would like to mention here as well that, unfortunately, we are not the masters of the timeline of the process, so don't complain to us if you think that these 10 weeks is not sufficient. Complain to the European Commission, which are our political masters. I would also like to mention in this second wave of advice that is coming now at the level 2 that there are two extremely important papers that are linked to our Pillar 3 related work on report to supervisors and on financial reporting. Quick flavor of Solvency II, and we don't have much time, and I'm sure that you want to focus more on the area of reporting. Well, main idea is that we are talking about a risk-oriented system. Ignacio mentioned the links with Basel II, with CRD, and I just would like to mention that the aligning principle is the same. I mean, we are putting forward or creating a mirror. A mirror reflects your risks and charges capital accordingly. But this is not cut and paste of the banking solutions. Thanks God, may I say again. What we aim with this? Well, unified legislative framework. This is extremely important. A clear link with the ISB work, which of course it's always well of the utmost importance. Well, a system that is developed to create a certain level of certainty, a certain level of confidence. We are based on a 99.5 confidence level to determine our capital requirements, and a system that does not provide for a zero failure system, because there we think that there could create a clear area of moral hazard in the insurance sector, both in life and non-life. Coming quickly to what the Lanfalussi approach, I was going to say to life, at least to regulation, means, in this case, a risk-based system provides with Pillar 1, Pillar 2, and Pillar 3. The Pillar 1 is dealing with the quantitative requirements, technical provisions which are there to cover for the expected losses. Insurance business is a little bit of a naive business and not easy to explain or to understand, but you all have probably a car and you all have a car insurance. What we do basically is we are pooling the risks in insurance, and when pooling the risks, and because of law of large numbers, you are basically getting a probability distribution in which you have some expected losses and some unexpected losses. Expected losses are determined and covered by the technical provisions, and unexpected losses are determined by the capital requirements of MCR and SCR. This is a little bit of what we are setting here. And when it comes to that, it is extremely important that this whole quantitative approach is supported rightly for the necessary qualitative approach, because some risk can be quantified, some other risk cannot be quantified, and we have to do something on that. But also because we were talking about Solvency II as a mirror that could reflect you and your risks. And I don't know if it happens the same with you, but since I got married, my wife pays a lot of attention to the mirror not reflecting a significant increase in risk, in this case in size. And it's exactly the same in insurance. You have a Pillar 2 that definitely needs to take this into account. You have to know your risks, you have to understand them, and you have to act accordingly. Last but not least, and this is the most important part here, Pillar 3, transparency, reporting, disclosure. Two issues here. The first one is we have to develop a system that provides confidence to the market. I don't know if you share my view that the market has lost a little bit of confidence on what they see, what they read, what they listen to. We have to work on that. But we also need a supervisory reporting system that is supportive of the whole risk-based system called Solvency II. This is what we're talking about, and I think it's now the right time to go and move to reporting requirements, which is what you all people are experts on. What our aims are in this area? The first one is to take into account our whole sector, which means the idea of proportionality, so we are not going to, in principle, require the same supervisory requirements to a large company as compared to an SME. This is extremely important, this idea of proportionality. The second one, at least in my opinion, more challenging and definitely interesting, is the whole idea of harmonization of supervisory reporting. Not only because there is a clear request from the political level, but also because there is a clear perception among supervisors that we have to advance in this area. The third one, well, promotion of comparability and compatibility. Comparability with other sectors, compatibility, for example, with IASB. Last but not least, we need to ensure sufficient and efficient supervision, because that's at the end our job. And if we don't ensure it, that means that we will not be doing our work rightly. This is a little bit on what we are going to be consulting right now on the basis of the Level 1 Directive and the papers that we are putting forward for the Level 2 Advice, a paper on report to supervisors and a paper on solvency and financial conditions. Well, what we have here is basically information that is required for supervisory purposes on the left side and information that is required for public purposes and that is therefore public financial reporting, to call it like that, on the right side. And we ask this information on a, let's say, predefined period basis, but that sometimes is not sufficient. We need something else. We need, for example, information because or upon occurrence of predefined events. And we are working on this area to make clear that predefined events are those that have material impact. But you know, material is one of these nice European English words that are so commonly used in Brussels that at the end nobody knows what understands. Well, if you read our papers and take your time on that, you will notice that we have even agreed on a definition of what material is supposed to mean in this particular case, because we are not that ambitious to try to go with a definition of material that could cover the whole use it is made of in the European political discussion and regulatory discussion. Last but not least, there is part of information that during inquiries regarding the situation of undertakers may be of interest to us, and that's also something that we need to ask for. It's important to notice that here we are talking about two sets of information, qualitative and quantitative information. If we focus on quantitative information, it's clearly the area in which platforms and toolkits like XBRL could have clearly a role to play. But there is, in a risk-based system, not only qualitative information, but also quantitative one that is needed to be taken into account. As I said, a couple of issues that I want to reflect on when it comes to reporting. I mean, we supervisors are sometimes blamed because of creating unnecessary administrative burden. And we are aware of this concern, and we are trying to give steps in the right direction to minimize that. But sometimes it is not just us that are, let's say, in the driving seat when it comes to generating this type of problems. Where can we find overlapping? Well, for example, with tax reporting, with central banks, Central Statistics Bureau, looking forward 2010, 2011, and all this trendy De La Rosia discussion, what about the European Systemic Risk Board? They are going to put forward this link between the macro and micro, because that has been one of the clear gaps in this crisis, and there will be a need of information. But who is to collect that information? Well, if we want to avoid this administrative burden and overlaps, clearly this information should be collected, among other reasons, for confidentiality reasons, by the supervisors and then processed, treated, and given to the systemic risk board. We are talking now about XBRL, and when you see this slide, it's clear that no decision has been made within CEOIPS with regards to the application for quantitative data of XBRL or other. And why not? Because we have, in a lengthy approach, a quite open and transparent process that demands consulting our stakeholders, looking within CEOIPS with our members what we are doing, what the needs we have are, what our capacities and potentialities as well. And last but not least, because we need to look at impact assessment of this whole situation to us supervisors, to entities as well. I'm talking now, and when it comes to XBRL, on challenges, opportunities, and risks. And let's start with the challenges, why not? Well, you can see at least a series of them. And the first one would be national specificities. There is, in some cases, such ad hoc national situations that national supervisors tell you, or regulators, well, we need to take this into account, how you do it within a global harmonized framework. A second one we could be talking about is definitions. This is extremely important. You can put together nice templates, you can put together nice names, and then it goes again, what is under this definition? This is something we are already working on, and believe me, it's not an easy task and an easy work, because at the end, we use national definitions, then we have to put them into European English, and sometimes European English is not the same in Spain, my country, Germany, the country I live in, or even the UK, which invented English, but it has nothing to do with European English at all. Challenges linked to the practices and previous frameworks in which we would be moving within the European level. Challenges linked as well to workload, costs, benefits, etc., etc. Well, there are challenges there, and we have to look at them, face them, and give a solution. By the way, when it comes to challenges and risks, I don't know if you have noticed the hidden message I'm sending. I have a green tie, which basically means green is the color of hope. So I'm going to send a clear message that whatever the challenges and the risks are, we are going to be able to find sustainable solutions. We were talking as well about opportunities. Well, exchange of information smoothly, rightly. Cross-border groups stopping complaining about 27 different reporting formats. Financial conglomerates as well could be mentioned here. And the easiness to build centralized database, which as you have seen before is one of the new challenges that this EIOPA is going to have to be carrying on starting the year 2010. What about some risks? Well, lack of expertise, that's clearly a risk and that's something you can work on, but sometimes it's not that easy as it sounds. The whole issue of timely reporting fulfillment with regards to different requirements, the aspects of small and medium entities, costs, burden, it's about money sometimes, cost benefit. National specificities, as I mentioned before, the whole idea of definition, etc. So there are risks as well in the project. And I was asked also to give a very short flavor with regards to the links between the work done in insurance and the work done in banking. And let's do it by this. This is Oscar Wilde, and he used to say that experience is the name we give to our mistakes. In this case, there is good and bad news from our banking colleagues. The bad news is that they have made mistakes. The good news is that they have made mistakes, which means they are advancing. Because that's precisely what we all have to do. We have to learn from what we have done wrong. We have to have clear our goals, our timelines, and our deliverables. Well, this is basically it. And thank you very much for your time and for listening to Insurance.